early morning, last day of the conference. I'm Sarah Lipschitz. I'm a grad student in Liz Derryberry's lab. And I'm going to talk to you about mating signals. So closely related lineages often vary dramatically in the signals that they use for courtship. And these signals are used in communication in the context of mate choice and territoriality and mate and defense, competition for mates. And there are numerous empirical studies that suggest that these signals are also important in species recognition, and that individuals use these signals to discriminate among closely related congeners. And because of this, it's thought that sexual selection plays an important role in speciation. And so for effective communication to occur, the receiver has to be able to recognize the relevant information content of a signal. And any breakdown in the process of communication, both in the context of mate choice and in competition, can reduce the likelihood of mating and therefore reduce gene flow. So when signals diverge between two populations, this decreases the likelihood that receivers will recognize the signals of the other population upon secondary contact. And hybrid zones are particularly good for studying pre-mating isolating barriers between divergent populations because they allow us to observe species interactions on our time scale, when this divergence process can happen over thousands or more years. And avian hybrid zones in particular are great systems to study these questions because in birds it's thought that pre-mating isolating mechanisms such as song rather than post-mating mechanisms such as hybrid and viability are the primary barrier between species. And so understanding divergent sexual signals and behavior can help us understand how species barriers are maintained upon secondary contact. And in this talk, I explore whether song is a behavioral barrier between two subspecies of white-crowned sparrows. So I'll introduce you to the study system of the white-crowned sparrow. I'm going to focus in on two players. They're different subspecies, Zonotrichia leucophrys pugitensis, the Puget Sound subspecies, and Nuttalli. So I'm just going to refer, this is the Nuttall subspecies, so I'm just going to refer to them as pugitensis and Nuttalli. And this is the distribution of pugitensis. And it's a migratory bird. In contrast, Nuttalli is a resident. And so these two subspecies interact here in this putative contact zone. And what's really kind of exceptional about this system is the geographic variation in song. So each of these songs is known as a dialect, and it's particular to one geographic locality. And so within the subspecies, there's quite a amount of variation in song, and also between the subspecies, and these are songs from the putative hybrids. And so the putative hybrid zone was documented by transitions in morphology in the 1960s and allozymes in the 1980s, but genetic techniques were not able to distinguish between these two subspecies. And so in asking whether song is a barrier to gene flow between these groups, we first want to characterize the genetic structure between them with the prediction that the subspecies should form distinct genetic clusters. And I'm going to present to you a series of predictions for this question, if song is a behavioral barrier to gene flow. So since we're using the hybrid zone as a natural laboratory for testing species barriers, we want to actually confirm that secondary contact is the best supported model of evolutionary history after divergence and a period of isolation. We also predict that songs are divergent between the subspecies. And so this is a prediction that they should differentiate in the space they take up in a number of temporal and spectral characteristics. And then they should be behaviorally isolated based on song. And so our predictions here, and I'll be showing you some graphs that look like these, is that they should respond more strongly to their own song than to the song of the other subspecies. So this is a paired test. And so I'll just remind you that song in sparrows is a keep-out signal for territorial competition between males. And so a lower response to an intruder song means a male would have a harder time holding a territory against that competitor, reducing the chance at mating and therefore reducing gene flow. And so this is one way of testing behavioral isolation because direct tests of females are challenging, although possible. And so alternative mechanisms to behavioral isolation between the two subspecies are that there's no difference in the discrimination or that there's some kind of asymmetric discrimination whereby one subspecies responds more, discriminates more strongly between its song and the other song of the subspecies, and the other has weaker discrimination. And so finally, to put all of this genetic and song and behavioral data together, we predict that all of these patterns will be associated. So this can help us understand the processes underlying these different patterns. And so in asking our question, we sampled across the hybrid zone at 17 different localities where we collected song and blood samples for genetic data. And we used genotyping by sequencing to generate over 6,000 SNPs for 169 individuals. And what we found was that the subspecies do form two distinct populations with admixture in between. So this is kind of confirming some of the historical work on the system. But with more markers, we were able to distinguish the subspecies. This was also confirmed using our principal components analysis. So fugitensis is distinct from nutteli, and hybrids are kind of somewhere in between. And we also find support for a model of secondary contact. So this is using historic demographic inference with collaboration with Isaac Overcast in the back end with Kickerson. And the time of isolation supports a Pleistocene glacial refugia hypothesis, which has been suggested for other taxa in that area. And then we summarized 14 different acoustic variables of both frequency characteristics and temporal time characteristics. We summarized these into principal components analysis. And we found that songs were correctly classified to subspecies using a discriminant function analysis. So I'm just going to play you some of these songs so you can hear how they sound. So this is that northern subspecies, fugitensis. This is from a population in Bandon, Oregon. And then here's one from nutteli in the south, in Bolinas, near San Francisco. And then these are two of our focal hybrid populations. So this is McCarriker and Manchester. So even though there's quite an amount of variation between these different dialects, we actually were able to find distinct differences so that the differences within a subspecies were smaller than between the subspecies. And we also found that genetic subspecies identity was a significant predictor of song structure. So interestingly, looking at particular song characteristics, we found that the whistle was the best variable to distinguish between the subspecies. So you can see here, nutteli tended to have longer whistles than fugitensis, but they also differed in their trill minimum frequencies, and overall, nutteli actually had shorter notes other than the whistle compared to fugitensis. Looking at song across the hybrid zone, so this is for song PC1, we actually find, so here's nutteli and here's fugitensis, that the hybrids, at least for PC1, were more similar to nutteli in their song characteristics, and this actually matched the genetic data, so these hybrids were genetically shared more of their admixture ancestry to nutteli. And then for our behavioral experiments, we did these simulated territorial intrusions. So what we did is we went and found a territorial male white cone sparrow, and we put a speaker on his territory and then played the song either of his own local population or of the other subspecies. And the things that we measured were how close does he approach to the speaker, so the average distance, as well as what is the rate of song production that he's singing on his territory, and how often is he flying over the speaker. So we did this in a paired design, and these focal populations, parental outside of the hybrid zone for both subspecies, as well as two localities in the hybrid zone. And what we found was that males responded more strongly to their own song than to the song of the other subspecies. So these are average values. And so I'll kind of walk you through. The two parental localities are down here, and then these are the two admixed ones. And some patterns that we see is that these admixed individuals actually responded more strongly to all simulated intrusions, regardless of the identity of their own or the other signal. So when we're talking about the height of these slopes, that's the strength of the response. But also, we can look at the strength of discrimination, so how steep the slope is. And so we found that although this was not significant, there was a trend that parental individuals discriminated more strongly, so that they had a steeper slope of discrimination between their own song and the song of the other subspecies to the admixed localities. And then looking at the association between song and genetic divergence, we found that one feature in particular, the whistle, which was also the significant predictor of subspecies identity, was correlated with genetic distance. And so, and this is after controlling for geographic distance. So this is really exciting to us because there are several behavioral and neurological studies that show the whistle may be important in species recognition, and actually may be an innate rather than a learned component of song, or have at least some kind of genetic template for innate. Comparing, kind of wrapping it all together, we found this really cool pattern. To me, I thought it was really interesting that the song dissimilarity, so the difference between the song that a male of the local population is singing and the song that we're playing to him from a foreign population, how different those songs were actually predicted the difference in behavioral response. So this suggests that they're responding differently because they're hearing and perceiving the song differently. We found that there was a relationship between the genetic distance of the populations and their difference in behavioral response. So that individuals discriminated more strongly between songs of more genetically distant and vocally distant populations. So to kind of summarize now everything I've told you, in trying to figure out if song is a behavioral barrier to gene flow, the subspecies do form genetically distinct clusters, but there is admixture between them. We found support for a model of secondary contact that indicates hybridization is ongoing. The genetic species identity did predict song structure. That was not a white cone sparrow. Behavioral isolation is strong between parental subspecies, but weakens in the hybrid zone, such that there was a trend for the admixed individuals to have a weaker response in discriminating. And we found that genetic song and behavioral divergence was associated. So I would take all of this together and include that song is an incomplete behavioral barrier between the subspecies. I was really excited by this whistle length pattern, and so in future work, I'd like to explicitly test it in white-crowned sparrows. Work in by Dai Shizuka and Emily Hudson is showing that in the golden-crowned sparrow, this whistle is innate, so that nestlings are responding just to the whistle alone in their species. I think that it's important to not just test male competition as a proxy for behavioral isolation, but really look at what the females are doing and how they're discriminating against song. And so this work was not possible without my supervisor, Liz Derryberry, who collected this data set over 12 years, and Rob Brumfield, my external committee member from LSU, as well as Mike Hickerson and Isaac Overcast. And thank you guys for your attention. Yeah, I don't remember which subspecies it was, but that's pretty striking because we expect that song is crystallizing really before dispersal is happening. So this has been a kind of contentious question in the field for a long time. Does dialect predict your different established? But I think we kind of, at least for this paper, stepped away from that argument and we're just looking at the subspecies. So dialect is definitely the next step for us. One last question.
Have you looked at mitochondrial DNA structure between these populations?
They share haplotypes. Mm-hmm. So, and actually share haplotypes with the golden-crowned sparrow. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that for us wasn't enough. And now we have a lot more SNPs, so we're trying to really get more fine scale structure. Right? More SNPs is always better, right? Thank you guys.